Holy crap. What an episode. That was like on a different level from the rest of this show. Wow. What's up, everybody? D-Man back. Welcome to a brand new video, and today we're going to be doing my review for Monarch Legacy of Monsters Season 1 Episode 9 titled Axis Mundi. Oh, there's so much to get into, so let's do it. This was the 9th episode of Monarch Legacy of Monsters. We only have one left and then the season is over, and this episode is the first episode to be directed by Andy Goddard. Oh my god, did it hit the ground running. There is so much going on in this episode and so much that I want to jump into. This was by far my favorite episode of Monarch Legacy of Monsters. I could not get enough of it. This was such an emotional episode, and I knew this one was going to be great from the very first scene because it was so different. It felt different than everything else that has come before, and it has a real weight to it, and it was incredible. This episode was packed full of great character moments, incredibly important plot developments, some cool kaiju action, but more importantly, a real emotional core that was built, thankfully, upon the rest of the show, and it made this episode so emotionally rewarding to watch. Having the context of the MonsterVerse, the films so far, made this episode even more rewarding. This is exactly the type of content that this show should be producing. As per usual, spoiler warning for Monarch Legacy of Monsters Season 1 Episode 9. This isn't going to be my plot-by-plot, beat-by-beat breakdown of the episode, but I am going to be going through my notes that I had while watching it. Thank you to Apple TV for the screeners for this episode. This was such a good one, and I thought it was going to be a good one based on the title, Axis Mundi, you know, playing upon the idea of the Hollow Earth. It just sounded a little more intelligent than some of the other episodes have been. And boy, was I right, because this episode was great. It's also fun because while I did get a lot of the predictions for this episode right, I also got a lot of them wrong, but I wasn't too wrong. I've gotten a lot better at predicting where this show is going. I still can't guess all the twists and turns, but I've gotten better at it. And whenever it doesn't go the way I think, it's typically a really good subversion of my expectations that leaves me really satisfied. All right, let's get into it. And I want to start out with the past plotline because that's the juice of the episode. It's so good. There is such a tangible weight to the opening of this episode. It felt different the second it started. This episode is so heavy. It's just this quiet, heavy, earnest episode. It is fantastic. This episode plays it straight. The MonsterVerse has a real problem with playing it straight. That's something I've ranted a lot about lately. I feel like the filmmakers involved in Godzilla films oftentimes don't have the confidence to be earnest with the material. They think they need to be making jokes. We've got a sci-fi world with a hollow earth. How are we supposed to take that seriously? You've got to make it silly, or you've got to just play into the bit. What if you don't? What if you didn't? What if you played it straight? This episode shows what happens when you play it straight, and for me, this was the MonsterVerse I've been wanting. This was taking me back to what I wanted the MonsterVerse to be all those years ago, and this gave it to me. This is what I like. It was so good. Not to say that I don't like the current stuff we're getting, but it is to say there was an enormous diversion that occurred at some point along the line, and while I do enjoy the current stuff, it's not the stuff I want. I can still enjoy a project, even if on a creative basis, I don't agree with the decisions being made. But on this side, they are first of all satisfying all of the creative wishes I wanted, while introducing new elements that maybe I wouldn't have gone with myself, like at the end of the episode, not something I would have done. But it's okay because they're handling it with such a level of care, it's really working for me. Going through the episode, Shaw and Hiroshi have this really beautiful dynamic at the beginning of the episode. Randa and Hiroshi also have a little beautiful scene at the start of this episode that shows how good of a father Randa was shaping up to be, but it's kind of overshadowed by the beautiful moment between Shaw and Hiroshi. It was so great. They have such a great little scene together, and it's really tragic. Shaw and Randa are also a power duo in this episode. The two of them are buddies, and I want to see more adventures with the two of them as buddies. They haven't been at odds the entire show, which I really respect. I really appreciate that this show hasn't gone the obvious route with the love triangle of making it something where the characters dislike each other. I like that they show this very nuanced take on the fact that Shaw does love Keiko, but he's not right for her, and he is still there for his friend Randa. And oh man, it was so wonderfully handled in this episode. It was just a great friendship between the two of them. I also loved the way they spoke about Keiko. Their love for her is so strong. I am so into setting this episode in the 60s. That was a great decision. I'm so glad they did that, made the time jump to after Keiko's death. It is such a good way to show these relationships develop and the world evolve. evolving and to show how far Monarch has come. The entire sequence at the beginning of this episode was amazing. I loved the co-dads thing going on where they were both the caretakers of Hiroshi. It was really sweet. I know Keiko would be so proud of them. I thought it was kind of crazy that there's just a random Hollow Earth portal in Kansas. I think the portal closed at the end of this sequence, so that's okay. I love that there is that Godzilla versus Kong style blue rift underneath it. I really appreciate the attention to detail there. And I also loved the reveal that Hourglass is the name of this project. Hourglass, of course, was the working title for this season, and now we know that's also because that was the test that they were going through here, and it kind of makes sense when you think about it. You've got the earth on top, and it's got the top part, and then you shoot inside, and then you spit out into the hollow earth part, so it's kind of like an hourglass in that way as well. Or if you want to view the planet as an hourglass, if you were to go down that hourglass logo right in the middle, there's the little part in the middle of the hourglass that still lets things through, and that would be the hollow earth in this case. More literally, it's because the Monarch logo is an hourglass. Puckett's speech was fantastic. It gave big shades of the speech given by Admiral Stans in the Godzilla 2014 trailer that was so great. The costume design was also on point. I loved the 1960s retro bright orange costumes. Those were fantastic. Great callback to 2001 A Space Odyssey. Great callback to Invasion of Astro Monster. That pod they were getting in felt very real and at the same time experimental and dangerous, and it had a real sense of things could go horribly wrong when they got inside of it. And then also Randa is dressed perfectly here, looking very Kong Skull Island. This character is clearly evolved a lot from episode one. Randa and Shaw's friendship is everything, and I'm so glad we got to see some scenes of the two of them being friends at the start of this episode. I thought the way that Randa and Shaw were teasing each other was great, but also the deep love and admiration these two men have for each other. It was so wonderfully portrayed. Randa clearly didn't want Shaw to go on this mission in case anything went wrong. He didn't want to put him in danger, but Shaw is a good guy and wants to do this. He's not going to put people on the line when he doesn't believe in the cause. I thought that was really well done. And it's so sad that Randa volunteered to go for him. You just see how much they care for each other. Puckett is still just killing it. Whenever he's on screen, he steals the show. I love that he's on board with the Hollow Earth. He's not denying it. He totally is aware of it. He believes it. He knows about the Titans. He's telling everybody else about the Titans. Yes, we know he's seen Godzilla, but you still have characters in this show who have seen Godzilla and then are going to deny that there are other Titans. And then you have characters like Puckett who know about the Titans and are like, okay, let's take care of it, guys. But yet he can't go above his orders. He can't go higher than his orders. And I think that's great. The reveal here in this episode that we need a Titan to get into the Hollow Earth, it didn't land for me because we know you don't. The Heebs in Godzilla vs. Kong can get in and out of the Hollow Earth, or at least that's what they're designed to do. So unless you're telling me that the reason Nathan Lynn's brother exploded on impact wasn't because of the gravity inversion, which is what they thought, but was because a Titan didn't open the portal? Maybe, because I suppose they do follow Kong into the Hollow Earth using the Heave, and they follow him out of the Hollow Earth using the Heave, but the movie tells us time and time again, you don't need Kong to get the Heave into the Hollow Earth. You can just get the Heave into the Hollow Earth. So unless Godzilla X Kong the New Empire is gonna show us that you need a Titan to get into the Hollow Earth, I'm gonna think that the Heaves are just built different and can just withstand whatever it is about the portal vortex that the Titans trigger. Which I don't love. It felt a little Terminator to me, where it was like only a certain type of thing can pass through the teleporter. I do know why they did it, because it's Pacific Rim. That's from Pacific Rim. You need a kaiju to get through the kaiju rift, and that's how the ending of Pacific Rim plays out. So from a kaiju standpoint, it is a fun little nod to Pacific Rim that I'm into. My question is though, how do you not hit the Titan on the way down? Like, you jump into the Hollow Earth after a Titan, how do you not just collide into it and die? You're both going so fast at each other at that point, would you not just hit it and explode? I don't know, I guess the Ion Dragon flipped around in there. But the entire opening of this episode was really dramatic and intense, and I'm gonna say it was the peak, man. It was the peak of this show so far. It was so well written, I loved it. And again, Randa's bravery, not only to first of all suggest that he should be the one that goes in, showing that he's also willing to save his buddy by going in, but also then to approach the portal as it's collapsing, was really great. It was a really great way to show how he's willing to take risks, which plays into who he becomes later. The moment inside the capsule while they were falling was also just terrifyingly done, calling back real life imagery of space travel tests gone wrong, where astronauts meet grisly fates, and it reminds us that this stuff does come at a real cost. Scientific exploration doesn't just happen peacefully. And then the ending, with Randa coming home to Hiroshi, it was just so heavy. Oh my god, it was good. It was so well done. I love the origins of the frantic, angry, and desperate Randa that we're starting to see brew here, and Anders Holm is doing such a good job of showing that change. We're also finding out here Monarch basically ran out of fumes in 1962, and from there they had to stretch their budget to the brink of collapse in 1973 in order to get the piggyback to go to Skull Island. We now know exactly why Monarch fell apart, and it's because people were scared of the stuff they were doing. They were doing dangerous stuff that people were freaked out by, and as we see here, if you don't understand what you're risking lives for, you're not going to be willing to risk your life. I thought that was really great. I also love the implied relationship here between Randa and Puckett, two characters who haven't really interacted in this show yet. They're portrayed as friends here. I thought it was really wonderful. It shows that there are more stories to be told that we haven't seen yet, which sets up for a season two. Not only does it do that, but it also builds this wonderful connection between the two of them so that they can share in the grief together. Puckett is a fantastically complex character where he fully believes in Monarch, fully believes in their mission, fully believes in Randa, and yet he doesn't have the authority to do anything about it. They are going to shut Monarch down and that's that. Randa's willingness then to surface a Titan in order to prove his point is exactly the person he becomes later on. That's exactly the mentality that led him to dropping bombs on Skull Island in order to draw a Titan to the surface. He eventually just pulls his plan off only to find that Kong's already on the surface waiting for them. That is the man he becomes, and we finally see that in this show. We are finally seeing the Bill Randa we know surface in this show, and for the first time in the entire season, I have felt like this portrayal of Anders Holmes' Bill Randa is the same character as the Bill Randa we meet in Kong Skull Island. That's great character development. I also love how everybody's friends, because it adds a level of weight and drama to the episode, and I love that Randa is unwilling to let go, and that to some degree, Puckett wants him to be proven right because he knows that that sacrifice shouldn't be in vain, but at the same time, he knows that there's nothing that can be done about it or should be done about it, and he also knows that Hiroshi has lost too much. And you know what? Puckett's right. It's because of Randa's unwilling ability to let go of the past that he gets himself killed and leaves Hiroshi without a father. Many times throughout this episode, it struck me that this whole thing plays like a horror movie, and never was that demonstrated better than when Shaw wakes up in the hospital and he is surrounded by the radiation tent and the people are coming in checking on him. It's so spooky. It's really creepy stuff, man. Also, it blew my mind seeing that Emiko was one of the nurses that took care of Shaw. I wonder why. Was she part of Monarch? Was that a Monarch hospital that they were at? I think it was. I think that's what they were saying. So Emiko is part of Monarch, or is she just associated with them and she was just associated vaguely with Hiroshi? I'm not entirely sure how that all worked out, but it seemed like Shaw was under the impression that he was already under the care of Monarch, and it seemed like he was because Hiroshi was there. Also, Christmas episode. There was a Christmas scene in this episode, and so I'm gonna say this is a Christmas episode. This is also the closest the Godzilla franchise has ever come to Christmas. I love that Shaw would want Randa to make him a sandwich. I thought that was really funny. It shows that he's not willing to trust people who aren't his friends, but it's a very Shaw thing to have Randa do, to be like, go make me a sandwich. I thought that was really funny. Hiroshi's appearance was insane. Blew my mind. I'm really impressed with the de-aging in this episode. I think they were de-aging their actors, and it looked really good. The reveal that we were in 1982 was also crazy, because it kind of, in a way, creates time travel in the MonsterVerse, but not in the way you'd think. Seems like you can move forward in time, but not backward through time, and maybe that's another reason that you want to take a heave through the Hollow Earth, because if you don't take a heave to the Hollow Earth, you're gonna get time dilated. So maybe that's one thing that the cast of Godzilla vs. Kong can avoid by using a heave. Otherwise, this is gonna be a big thing for them, right? Those guys, every time they come to the surface, are gonna be decades in the future. Like, that's clearly not what happens in the movie. Which means if we're going in and out of the Hollow Earth, we need a heave, otherwise time is all sorts of messed up. The first meeting between Hiroshi and Emiko was really delicate, and Emiko's warmth and ability to push Hiroshi to accept Shaw was really great. She's such a well-developed character, and I like that she pointed out he did keep his promise. He came home. It didn't happen the way he thought it would. Then we get into the whole crazy plot twist ending of the episode where Hiroshi is already with Monarch, which I didn't expect. I thought him and Shaw were going to join Monarch together. Shaw was going to be such an extremist that he was going to get himself locked up, but no. We find out that Hiroshi's already with Monarch and just wants to know what happened, and when Shaw explains it, it is horrific. The Ion Dragon appeared and attacked, which is great because it brings him back from the second episode, now in the second to last episode, setting him up as the threat in the next episode. The only thing that threw me off a little bit was like why Shaw didn't recognize it. I felt like Shaw should have been like, oh my god, I've seen that guy before. Also, how does nighttime work in the Hollow Earth? I know I have pitched in videos before that I feel the Hollow Earth lighting should be caused by the Hollow Earth energy source, not by a sun down there, and that the energy source kind of pulses, which means it diminishes, and as it does, it becomes nighttime. They're probably not going to explain it, but I would love an explanation because later on we just see the sun down there. We also saw the freaking sun down there in Godzilla vs. Kong, and it made no sense. That was some crazy epic slow-mo at the end of this episode. It was terrifying, it was really well handled, and the Ion Dragon looked crazy. The one thing that threw me off about it was Shaw comes to the surface and somehow learns the lesson that Godzilla is the key to keeping nature's balance. I think it would have been more interesting if they went down there and they were attacked by a different creature, not the Ion Dragon, and it was Godzilla who appeared and saved them, and Shaw realized Keiko was right, Godzilla should not be killed, Godzilla is here to restore balance, oh my god, we gotta help Godzilla out. That would be a better motivation for him, but there was no Godzilla to be seen. I guess that when you get sucked through the Hollow Earth portals, you get rifted back to the surface, time gets all messed up, because that's what happens to Shaw. Not entirely sure why he got sucked into the portal after the Ion Dragon, that didn't make a ton of sense to me. They say that a portal collapsing causes a whirlwind, but for some reason Shaw is sucked through one anyways? Whatever the portal got sucked into must have sent Shaw to the rift in Japan, that's at least what we're being told, which somehow caused some sort of time dilation. I don't understand how, but maybe they'll explain that in the next episode. Poor Randa, we find out that that man got no respect from anybody, even after Skull Island, he wasn't proven right, which we did know. After Skull Island, Brooks comes back, presents evidence to Monarch about the Hollow Earth, and basically everybody's like, Brooks, the island you were on was hollow, not the Earth, shut up about the stupid theories. I like that this show is keeping that intact. I would like a little bit more acknowledgments of Houston Brooks. I think that he is a big enough character that he should show up in this show. I'd love if they brought Corey Hawkins back for some scenes set in the 70s and 80s. That'd be really interesting to see that character interact with Hiroshi, considering both of them were in many ways son-like figures to Bill Randa. That poor man never got any respect even from his own son. Hiroshi was the one who sent Shaw away for study. I don't love, there's a lot of question marks about that, but it was an interesting kind of betrayal for Hiroshi to be like, you've burned me so bad, goodbye. That doesn't really build the implied relationship between those two characters that Emiko mentions in episode 2, where she says following Randa's death in 1973, Shaw wound up having to look after Hiroshi, and it's actually kind of the other way around. They didn't really do a good job of explaining that, which makes me think Emiko knows way more than she's letting on. It looks like Hiroshi has taken the some enemies don't exist until you go looking for them approach, and he just wants the monsters to be left alone, which I do think is an interesting approach, and I hope that they bring that moral debate to the MonsterVerse more prevalently of, if we just leave the Titans alone, we wouldn't have the problems we have, because that was a big key thematic argument in Kong Skull Island that I would love to see brought back. But I was surprised that Hiroshi wasn't more curious about the portal to the underworld. He just dismissed it and was like, whatever. The guy came back from the dead and is younger than ever. How are you not like, okay, what happened down there? I need to go find out what's in that portal. I guess maybe eventually he does when he starts to use the satellites to look at Earth, but that's decades later. And it's crazy to see that they threw Shaw's entire life away, although he disagrees, he thinks that they didn't. They made him go full One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, just taking pills and drugs to put himself in a stoop where he can't even recognize that all this time is passing and he's just passive. It's still a little weird though, because enough time has passed between the 1980s and 2014 that more stories have to be told with Shaw. We know for a fact Shaw had a few escape attempts because it's brought up in a previous episode, and we also know that he has a relationship with Verdugo, like a pretty developed one, considering they have a pretty developed relationship in episode 5. So unless she goes and visits him every single day in his little retirement home, maybe she does. I think that there's got to be a lot more adventures with Shaw between then and now. Also, Shaw knows a lot more about Monarch in between then and now, and he also has friendships on the outside. He knows that guy he bumps into in the desert in episode 6. He also is friends with Duho, who we have no evidence that he has met yet. So in order to show more adventures, we have to find out that while this scene was effective in showing that they essentially threw his whole life away, it didn't work the way it told us. He still has lots of adventures in between then and now. He just always returns back to this hospital and never makes it out in the long term. And that brings us to the present day plot, where there's not as much going on, but the stuff that we had was so juicy as well. How long were they waiting for Kentaro to wake up? That was kind of silly to me that Tim and Verdugo were just standing there, but I did like finding out that Duval was the one that saved Tim and Kentaro last episode. It was also kind of crazy to hear that everybody else got taken in or killed by the authorities there. What happened to Duval after that? I mean, we don't really find out yet. I'm gonna assume that she's not back with Monarch and that she went with Shaw's people, but she's off the grid, or so we're told in this episode. We just don't see her. I like how Kentaro's immediate concern is Cate. Not May, not that love plot. It's Cate, his sister, and he just wants her back and his friends back. That's his first priority. I also like how heartbroken he was to hear that they died and how he still cares for Lee Shaw as well. That's still family to him. And holy crap, what an amazing tear-jerking performance. This episode is the first episode of Monarch Legacy of Monsters to make me tear up. I thought it was so well written and so well handled. Ren Watabe kills it in this episode. episode, his performance is so incredible. Putting in an award-worthy performance here, the pain and desperation and sorrow he feels, it's so tragic and well portrayed. I hated that the characters survived the fall into the Hollow Earth. It's the dumbest thing to happen in the MonsterVerse, but it's fine because we don't find out how they survived, so we don't have to worry about it. We just pick up and they're knocked out, which is better for me because then I don't have to see it and dwell on how bad it was. And it was okay because it opened the gateway to a wonderful story with a fantastic depiction of the Hollow Earth. We still don't see the sky above the sky in this show just yet, but the fantastic light display above them was really well done. And the dense atmosphere they were in, it felt like an entirely new universe. It was really cool. How is there a sun above the trees? I don't know. I would have preferred if there wasn't, but it did give way to some beautiful visuals. The lightning storm that occurred was so badass. It was really exciting to watch. I loved all that going on. It created a really interesting obstacle for the characters in this episode. That was a lot of fun. And that little bug that popped up out of nowhere, it was so cool. It just felt so classically Skull Island. And I don't mean the MonsterVerse Skull Island. I mean, those little glowing bugs felt like Peter Jackson's Skull Island to me. I really liked that. I also really liked that Kentaro is back, baby. Back to being written as the character he should be. He is back wanting to take care of things and get to the bottom of things like he was through the first 6 episodes of the show before they completely changed his character for the last 2. And I love that he is still in it for Cate. I love that. I didn't want the May thing because, again, it's like, if we're gonna do a love triangle, at least have it be as nuanced as the one in the past, where it's like, well, the love happened in the past and that's no longer Kentaro's concern. He just wants his sister to be safe. Shows that he's a family man and it develops him beyond someone who's just a love interest. I like that. Emiko's encouragement of Kentaro to keep pursuing things was great, and it calls back to episode 2 when she bails him out of the Monarch chase in the first place. Shout out to Shaw in this episode for still trying super hard to look after May and Cate despite causing them trouble and it being his fault. He's still just in it to look after them and didn't expect this to go off the rails as much as it did, and it's them who is his priority. Oh my god, that was one of the most brutal scenes in the entirety of the MonsterVerse, I think. Kentaro's first meeting with Hiroshi was crazy well handled. The writing is so good. I love that Hiroshi immediately shows up. He's preoccupied and he's freaked out by the fact that he spotted Kentaro, but then he immediately jumps into dad mode. He immediately starts to reprimand Kentaro as his child and be like, "What were you doing in the desert, young man?" And Kentaro's like, "You've lost that privilege. You didn't even care to check in on me to make sure I survived that incident. You're the worst." And then you're finding out Hiroshi's so preoccupied on trying to save the world or whatever it is that he's doing that he's only just now starting to realize the danger he put his kids in. I also like that he scolds Kentaro at first, being like, "You shouldn't have found out about my secret life and all my lies," and how he's turned out to be a way worse father than either of the father figures he had. I thought that was great. And I also thought it was great the way Kentaro was like, "You're the problem, man, not us, it's you." And the way Hiroshi realizes that, as far as he's aware, he caused the death of his child, it was heartbreaking. His performance was heartbreaking. Takehiro Hira plays Hiroshi in this show, and he's so good. There's so much emotional depth to that character. It's so good, man. I could just praise this episode all day. I thought the whole thing was so good. I love a good emotional Godzilla story, and this was one. And then the ending of the episode happened, and it wasn't my jam, but I also didn't hate it. I'm surprised Cate didn't just get blown up by the lightning charges as she was just laying there on the ground right in the center of the static electricity storm that occurred. After the rift closed, she should have been vaporized, but whatever, she survived, that's fine. I am surprised that Shaw and May didn't think to go back to the portal to look for her and be like, well, maybe she's still knocked out somewhere. I'm surprised they didn't just go back in once the lightning storm calmed down. The Boar Titan appearing was awesome because it felt so freaking Skull Island, not only in the way it behaved, where it kind of left Cate at first and then circled back as an aggressor, but I also loved the design, where it was flora and fauna merged together, and building in these flora-fauna monsters is such a great way of showing that consistency to Skull Island. It also goes back to what Eileen Andrews was saying, where she says, Skull Island is basically just Hollow Earth come to the surface. So the Boar Titan sequence was awesome, and the way it gets speared and runs away was fine. I'm not a big fan of that trope where it's like character stranded in place shows up to save the day. It's almost always done poorly, I think. So I'm curious to see how they do it here, but it was cool to see that it was Keiko. I just don't get why she's so young. Maybe it's so that you can keep using the actress? And I guess I get that. Mari Yamamoto could do a great job joining the cast of the present day characters, and it would be super interesting to see her dynamic with the modern characters, with her grandchildren, and with Monarch especially. That will be great. Can't wait to see her interact with Lee Shaw. That's gonna be some mind-blowing stuff right there. That is gonna be an emotional-ass performance from Kurt Russell, I think. I think that's gonna be crippling. Why is she so young? Like, no time passed for her at all? How does that work? Are we saying that the longer you're in the Hollow Earth, the less you age? age because Gia aged 5 years in 5 years. So what is up with that? She's living in the Hollow Earth now. All the Godzilla X Kong characters live in the Hollow Earth. So if you're gonna do this de-aging thing, you've gotta make sure it's consistent. And so far, nothing in the MonsterVerse would tell us that that is a rule of the Hollow Earth. I guess you could say, well, there's that one area that causes time dilation. Don't go there. Okay, that's stupid. Whatever. Either way, I'm excited to see her interact with the modern cast. I think that's gonna be some crazy stuff. Okay, what did you think of this one? I was all about this. This was my favorite episode of Monarch Legacy of Monsters, and I am so ready for the next episode off the back of this one. I'm so curious to hear what you thought. Comment down below and let me know what you were thinking about this one. As always, I want to give a huge thank you to my patrons over on Patreon. If you want to support the Patreon, you can use the link in the description below. And by supporting the Patreon, you are directly supporting this channel and making sure that I can continue to make videos like this for you. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed. I will see you guys next time for the next one. D-Man, out.